mysterious people in the darkness of the past, the Germanic tribes. The Romans called them barbarians. They considered them savages without any culture. Were battle and war all they were familiar with? What did they believe in? What did they fear? What was their relationship with Rome, the world power? What have they left behind, and what do we know about them? Who were the Germanic tribes? ...1956, near Hamburg in northern Germany. During building works, a surprising discovery was made. A Germanic cemetery from the first century. A stroke of luck for archaeologists. Researchers found something quite surprising in a broken urn. The tip of a pilum, the dreaded javelin used by Roman legionaries. Why did a Germanic person have a Roman weapon in his grave? We don't know who this weapon belonged to. Not a single life story from this time has come down to us. But archaeological discoveries and new scientific insights make it possible for us to picture the life of a Germanic warrior. Let's call him Notke. Since Caesar's days, Germanic warriors and Roman legionaries had often met in battle. Rome's power seemed invincible. More and more tribes had to submit to it. But then, in the year 9 AD, the Germans mounted a rebellion. Their fight for freedom would change the course of history.
I was the bodyguard of Arminius, our leader in our fight for freedom. I protected him with my life. We had to leave our home, the land of the Cherusci, when we were children, almost 20 years ago.
It is the year 8 BC. After a long and bloody war, the tribe of the Cherusci had to submit to the Romans. Rome forced them into an alliance. In return for peace, the prince of the Cherusci had to pay a high price. His own son. Far away from home, in Rome, Arminius became a hostage who had to vouch for his people's loyalty. The Cherusci shared the fate of subordination with the other Germanic tribes between the Rhine and the Elbe. They all had to follow Rome's orders and pay high tributes.
Was it not now that Arminius needed the help of his friend? I couldn't let him go by himself, and I wanted to share in his lot. Thus it happened that Arminius and I were taken from the land of the Cherusci to Rome. We thought this farewell was forever. The legionaries were good to us. We would forget our home, they told us. A life of luxury awaited us. Gladiator fights and chariot races in the magnificent city of Rome where the Emperor Augustus ruled.
One such scene is depicted on a Roman gold coin. It is kept in the Border Museum in Berlin, home of the world's largest coin collection. Evidently, it was Rome's standard policy to take children of conquered tribes as hostages.
Augustus ließ sich die Geiseln von den besiegten Fürsten.
Augustus had hostages brought to him from the conquered chiefs for two reasons.
Die Kleinkinder dienten zum einen dazu.
Number one, the small children helped secure the peace. The prince, who knows his child's life would be in danger if he started a war again, would be much less likely to do so than if this weren't the case. And number two, the Romans were convinced that children who grew up in Rome and were raised there would turn into real Romans.
echten Römern werden würden.
They came into the imperial family or to the closest relatives. So they grew up like members of the upper class, learned Latin, participated in festivals, and were socialized as Roman.
Und wurden römisch sozialisiert.
From the forests of the north to Rome, for the prince's son Arminius, a culture shock of the first order. Rome, the empire's capital, was the navel of the world. Magnificent temples, palaces, and baths were all expression of the great power and size of the empire. Aqueducts, hundreds of kilometers long, supplied the city with fresh water. Impressive testimonies to Roman wealth, such as the Forum Romanum, have survived thousands of years, thanks to Emperor Augustus's building program.
I found a city of brick and left one of marble.
The Altar of Peace celebrated the beginning of a new age under Augustus. Child hostages are also depicted as guarantors of peace between Rome and her conquered enemies. Rome's first emperor had created a new stability, both at home and with other peoples. Pax, the goddess of peace, was honored with a procession. At its head were the imperial family and the Roman nobility. Soon the Germanic hostage Arminius would also be part of this Roman elite.
As young men, Arminius and I joined the Roman army. We proved our worth in the war against the rebellious tribes in Pannonia. As a reward, Augustus made Arminius a Roman knight, which was the second most important rank after the senatorial rank in Rome. In the eyes of the Romans, we were nothing more than savage barbarians. But now, we were finally part of their world.
Full of appreciation, one of Arminius's former comrades said,
"He was a young man of noble origin, personally very brave, quick to understand, and unusually gifted for a barbarian."
Arminius war römischer Bürger und ist sogar in den Ritterstand.
Arminius was a Roman citizen and was even awarded the equestrian rank. This offered him glittering prospects for the future. On the one hand, he could have remained a leading figure in his tribe, the Cherusci. He would have led the Cherusci soldiers, their troops, instead of Roman auxiliary troops. And on the other hand, he could have a wonderful career ahead of him in his capacity of knight. He would have been integrated into the structure of the Roman Empire and administration. Just like it was for fellow Gauls, who, as leaders of their tribes, had a fabulous career in the Roman Empire.
Innerhalb des Römischen Reiches eine fantastische Karriere machen konnten.
Under Augustus, Arminius's home had become a Roman province. Rome erected military camps in order to secure the conquered area, on the Rhine and on rivers that led into the country's interior. In the north, the Lippe became a strategically important waterway. Using rivers such as the Lippe, Romans were able to transport supplies. There were, after all, no surfaced roads in Germania. For the Romans, it was still a forbidding world. The chronicler Tacitus wrote,
"Germania's forests are fearful, its swamps are ghastly."
Directly on the Lippe, to the north of the modern city of Dortmund, was a fortified Roman complex in the middle of agricultural countryside. The military camp, dating from the time of Augustus, could support an entire legion, around 6,000 soldiers. They were the elite troops of the Roman army. But this camp was not just of military significance. An unusually large number of administrative buildings were discovered here. That's why archaeologists think that it was the administrative headquarters of the new province. It was from here that the empire kept the Germanic tribes in check.
The land of Cherusci, our home. We'd been away for almost 20 years, Our god of thunder, Thor, gave us a proper welcome. Everything seemed familiar. We'd almost forgotten that we'd come to Germania on Rome's orders.
It's likely that Arminius was sent to his homeland in order to command a unit of Germanic auxiliary forces. Since Caesar's times, the allied Germanic tribes had had to provide soldiers. They were particularly valued as mounted warriors because Rome did not have its own cavalry. The chronicler Cassius Dio praised the Germanic warriors as exceptional horsemen. Masked bronze helmets were found amongst the mounted units of the Roman auxiliary troops. What were they used for? They were hardly suitable for combat. The masked helmets probably served to protect the face during training and during combat displays. The riders probably also wore the masks at parades. Perhaps the helmets were supposed to hide the barbaric appearance of the foreign men from the Romans at public displays.
Arminius was supposed to help the governor, Varus, build up the province because Rome had big plans for Germania.
In 1993, archaeologists discovered a Roman complex dating from the time of Augustus further south at Wald Girmes in the valley of the Lahn, a tributary of the Rhine. Since then, one surprise after another has surfaced at the excavation site. Archaeologist Armin Becker has been leading the dig right from the start. The research results so far have thrown a whole new light on the Roman Empire's policies for Germania. Layer by layer, he examined the secrets of the loamy ground and thus made this crucial discovery.
The first scientific soil examinations initially suggested another military camp dating back to Augustan times, but then the archaeological excavations presented a completely different picture. The settlement was divided by two roads. Along the roads was a development of wooden buildings that followed the roads and basically created a block-like impression. This was in contrast to military camps where the barracks were arranged in lines next to each other.
Wald Girmes was a purely civilian Roman town, founded right in the middle of a recently conquered Germania. A sensation for the archaeologists. For a long time, such a possibility was questioned. To this day, this is the only Roman town to be found east of the Rhine. The ancient name of the town is unknown, but researchers have been able to reconstruct its appearance from the discoveries they made in the ground. The town was still under construction and was oriented towards expansion. Generations of Roman merchants and craftsmen were meant to settle here. It was a town based on the Roman model and a shop window of Roman civilization. Atrium houses with baths and running water, flowering gardens, and a forum built of stone. Why did the Romans make such an effort in what they regarded as a land of barbarians?
Mit Wald Girmes haben wir das Paradebeispiel dafür.
With Wald Girmes, we have a prime example of how Rome went about making a newly conquered territory into a Roman province. Initially, they had to occupy the area with their army. This phase was over. And in the second phase, Rome evidently felt secure enough to also found a town in this area. A town which provides a clear indication that Rome wanted to establish her rule here long term.
But the discoveries in Wald Girmes have revealed even more. Armin Becker and his excavation team have been documenting all the traces in the ground for later evaluation. To do this, they use a drawing tool called a pantograph. With its help, they're able to create scale floor plans of wells, houses, and plazas. Archaeologists enter every single discovery they have made in this excavation area into these plans. This will give them an image of what the inhabitants of this town left behind. Every discovery made in the loamy soil, never mind how minor, is worthy of the attention of the archaeologists. Even shards can give information about who used to live here. Were all of the settlers Roman? Or were there also Germans living in the newly founded town? The shards are meticulously examined in the storeroom so that they can be put together later. Archaeologist Gabriele Rasbach can tell from how the pottery was worked whether it is of Roman or Germanic origin. Unlike the Roman pottery, Germanic pottery was made without a potter's wheel. As it turns out, almost one shard in seven was not of Roman origin. The researchers also found metal objects like this small Roman anvil. But metal discoveries are the exception here, in contrast to Rome's military camps in Germania. The body of discoveries from Waldgirmes is characterized by two peculiar features. We have just one pilum tip, that is to say, one Roman weapon in the entire collection. But then there are many mixed batches of Roman and Germanic pottery. Both of these things indicate that there must have been peaceful coexistence between Roman and Germanic people here in Waldgirmes. Roman crockery alongside Germanic pots, symbols of the new friendship. Amongst the Germanic upper class, luxury goods from Rome were popular status symbols. They exchanged food for finely crafted glass beads and ornate jewelry. The blonde hair of the Germanic women was particularly popular and was fashioned into hairpieces for the fashion-conscious ladies in Rome. The discoveries at Waldgirmes confirm a statement made by the Roman chronicler Cassius Dio, one that was questioned for a long time.
The Roman troops founded towns and the Bavarians adapted to their arrangements. They got used to the markets and met there in peaceful gatherings. We marveled at the choice of goods we'd never before seen in Germania. It was a Roman market in the midst of Germania. But then we saw legionaries by the side of a Roman tax collector. When Rome gave something to her subjects, she always demanded something back in return. It conformed to the treaties. Germania was now a Roman province. Peace and security had their price. Whoever didn't pay what the emperor demanded had to reckon with the wrath of Rome. But Rome wasn't allowed to treat our people as subordinates, as slaves. We knew the pride of the Germanic tribes.
Flourishing towns like Waldgirmes were supposed to demonstrate the advantages of Roman civilization to the Germans. As Tacitus put it,
the building of forum complexes, houses and baths were used to entice the newly subjected tribes to peace and calm.
In 2005, archaeologists made a discovery in Waldgirmes that finally may be able to answer the open question as to the exact year the town was founded. They found the foundation of a wooden well. It had survived for over 2,000 years in the groundwater. The wood is going to be sent for examination to a laboratory specializing in dendrochronology, a method of age determination. Full of excitement, the planks are being prepared for transport before they've even had time to dry. The vital question now is there a reference pattern for this wood? A tree's cross-section shows the growth rings it forms every year. The rings of all trees from the same region and the same time have identical patterns. Chalk can help highlight this pattern. The growth rings from the well planks in Waldgirmes are placed under a microscope and scanned into a computer. Dendrochronologist Torsten Westphal compares them with the growth ring patterns of trees from the same region, which can be positively dated. And indeed, the researchers are in luck. By means of a reference pattern, they're able to determine when the wood for the wells was felled.
The planks from the well in Waldgirmes can be clearly dated. We were able to determine that the tree they came from was felled in the year 4 BC. We have an exact date. They were presumably made into a well the following year. That's generally the way it's done. Freshly cut wood is usually sawn the following spring because it's easier to handle. We didn't find any desiccation cracks in the wood that would indicate that it had been stored for a longer period of time.
A surprising result. The civilian Roman town of Waldgirmes was already founded in 4 BC, at a time when there was still fighting going on in other parts of Germania. But there are further questions awaiting the archaeologists. They found around 180 gilt bronze pieces. What were they a part of? Archaeologist Gabriele Rasbach is searching for answers. Her first insight: all the fragments came from a statue that appears to have been destroyed on purpose. The bronze pieces were distributed over the entire excavation site. Through comparisons, Gabriele Rasbach has found out that one of the fragments was part of a horse's bridle. Was this an equestrian statue? And if so, whom did it depict? Since the Roman town at Waldgirmes was founded during the time of Emperor Augustus, a gilt bronze equestrian statue in the Forum can only have been of the divine Augustus. The statue showed the emperor as a symbol of new order. Germania would be part of the empire forever. The governor, the long arm of the emperor, would see to it. Since the year 7 AD, Varus was the governor of Germania. With an iron hand, he transformed the conquered land into a Roman province. The chronicler Paterculus described him as arrogant and power-hungry.
To Varus, the Germans are wild animals who have nothing in common with humans except for their voice and their bodies. Since it hadn't been possible to subdue them with swords, they now had to be tamed with Roman justice. His punishments were arbitrary and excessive. He treated our fellow countrymen like subordinates, not like Roman subjects. Arminius asked Varus not to injure the honor and pride of the Germans, but the governor rebuked him. He knew exactly how barbarians were to be treated. Arminius shouldn't forget that Augustus had made him a knight and that he was now a Roman and not a German anymore. Up until this point, Arminius had believed in Rome's goodwill towards the Cherusci and in Roman justice.
Varus's portrait could be seen on Roman coins. He enjoyed high standing in Rome.
Varus had the best contacts with the imperial family. There were even family ties there. He'd previously been stationed in Syria, and there he'd been successful in creating order and calm. Of course, he used the customary and often brutal methods. He definitely wasn't squeamish, but he was successful, and Syria was a difficult province at the time. After the meeting with Varus, we finally wanted to see our family again. How had our clan fared under Roman rule? We hoped they were doing well, because by then we'd heard terrible rumors.
We are told about numerous executions in Germania at that time. Varus was known for his merciless and drastic measures. When he had been the governor of Syria, he had had several thousand people crucified after a revolt. It was a dreaded punishment that killed its victims slowly and painfully. And the final humiliation was that the death throes took place in front of everyone.
Finally, we arrived in our village, but it was a sad reunion. The tribal priest was there. He was preparing the chief of the Cherusci for his last journey to Votan, our supreme god. Segima, Arminius' father, was on his deathbed. He told his son about the humiliations the Cherusci had suffered at the hands of Rome. The chief regretted very much having entered into the alliance with Rome. He felt betrayed. Rome had broken her promises. Segima made his son swear he would no longer put up with the oppression and the injustice. From then on, Arminius was responsible in his father's place for the tribe and its future. Arminius realized that as chief, he would take on his father's legacy and fulfill his last wish.
Until then, the Cherusci chief had proved a loyal ally to Rome. As Tacitus wrote,
"No mortal stands above the Germans when it comes to loyalty."
But Rome disregarded the law, the customs, and the values of the Germans that had been handed down for generations. With that, they had gone too far. Arminius took on his father's legacy. He was no longer able to be a friend and ally of Rome. As the chief of the Cherusci, he would fight for his people's independence. But what chance did he have against Rome's military might? How could he win back Germania's freedom? Already 20 years earlier, the Germans had fought long and hard against the Roman invasion, but to no avail. One Roman sarcophagus celebrates the victory over the barbarians of the north. In the year 4 AD, Germania was finally conquered after a long war with many casualties. A contemporary witness reported,
"In one battle, so many Romans and barbarians fell that the dead hemmed the flow of the river."
In the end, the Germans had to subordinate themselves to Rome's war machine after all. Woe betide the conquered, it was said in Rome. The Germanic warriors were openly threatened.
"You, Germania, have no right to mercy. Barbarians, you will pay with your lives."
Relief stones from Moguntiacum, the legionary stronghold on the site of present-day Mainz, show Germanic captives. In Rome, the populace was overjoyed.
"While Germania is conquered like the rest of the world and has to subordinate itself to the emperors with bent knees."
The coin collection of the Bode Museum in Berlin has Roman coins that celebrate the victory over the Germans. Germania capta, Germania is conquered. The imperial propaganda announced. How did Rome treat the conquered tribes?
When a victor speaks about Germania capta, then the loser is considered a prize. This was an attitude Rome had towards its provinces for a long time. The provinces secured Rome's wealth. The fact that the exploited provinces were none too happy about this expressed itself in revolts.
The same was to happen in Germania. In the year 9 AD, the resentment about Rome's rule was great. Historians assume the Bructeri, the Marsi, the Chatti, and the Cherusci met at the Thing, a holy place where they could confer about a revolt. Before the Romans had come to their country, many tribes had been bitter enemies. Now they were united by the same fate. The chronicler, Florus, wrote about the growing antipathy of the Germans towards the rule of Rome.
They started to hate Quinctilius Varus's excesses and pride just as much as his cruelty. Arminius tried to convince the Germans, who hadn't yet noticed that the laws of Romans were crueler than weapons. It was time to act before the swords of the Germanic warriors became rusty and their horses weak.
But not all of them followed his call to revolt. Segestes, another Cherusci chief, got along well with the new masters. The tribes were torn. Tacitus tells us that Arminius gave the warriors a choice.
If they wanted a home free from Roman rule, they should follow him. He would lead them to fame and freedom. Segestes, however, would lead them to shameful servitude. But Segestes warned that we were hopelessly inferior to Varus and his legions. A revolt against Rome was tantamount to suicide. The Romans would ravage the land, kill us, and take our women and children as slaves. It was better to be their friend than their enemy. We would all profit from the Romans' wealth and luxury. But the tribes followed Arminius.
These standing stones, known as the Stone Dance of Boitin, are near the city of Rostock on the Baltic. In Germanic times, this was a thing site, a sacred venue for assemblies. The place where Arminius called for a revolt against Rome could have looked just like this. Freedom or death, Tacitus recounts how the Germans voted on such issues.
All the men decide together about the most significant issues for the tribe. The power of persuasion is more important than a man's position of power. If they dislike a proposal, they reject it by grumbling. But if they like it, they bang their weapons together.
Why did the majority of the tribes follow Arminius's call?
I think one crucial aspect is that the Romans also tried to force Roman law and administration and all of these things onto the Cherusci and other Germanic tribes. That would have caused great misgivings within their society. And I can well imagine that that was the main reason for Arminius.
The alliance between the Germanic tribes was forged. Arminius knew they would need to use cunning if they wanted to come out on top against the superpower that was Rome. Only if Varus and his legions could be lured into a trap would the Germanic warriors have a hope of victory. The Roman historians report that Arminius was a close confidant of the governor. Varus heard rumors about a conspiracy centered on Arminius, but he disregarded the warnings. Tacitus wrote,
Varus fell for the fate and the power of Arminius.
Arminius told Varus about a rebellion that had supposedly broken out in a remote area of Germania. He advised Varus to go there with his legions and nip the problem in the bud. He succeeded. Varus was convinced. Was Varus's gullibility as absurd as the chroniclers reported? Why should Varus think of Arminius, a Roman knight, as a traitor and not an ally? He was dependent on Arminius. As the leader of the Germanic auxiliary forces, he knew the Germanic soul and the land better than anybody. Varus issued the order to mobilize the army, just as Arminius had advised. The cunning plan seemed to be working. Later, the historian Paterculus jeered.
Varus thought the goodwill he was being shown was something he had earned. But unconcern is the most frequent start of disaster.
In the autumn of the year 9 AD, Varus set off with the 17th, 18th and 19th legions in order to put down the alleged disturbances. Varus had three legions, auxiliary troops, and their baggage. up to 30,000 people march through Germania as if it were a friendly country. He did without scouts and flank protection.
So far, everything had been going according to plan. As an advance guard, we led the army into thick forest. It was unknown terrain for the Romans. We hoped Varus wouldn't become suspicious. Would he follow us along the narrow trail? In an open battle, we would have no chance against the technically and tactically superior troops.
When the open land gave way to the narrow forest trail, the disciplined order of the marching column dissolved, and discipline was the Romans' strongest weapon. Unsuspecting, Varus and his legions followed Arminius ever deeper into the thick forest. Now Arminius had the Romans exactly where he wanted them. The Roman army was cut off from all lines of retreat. In the forest, the legion's marching column became very stretched. It straggled for kilometers. If the Romans were to be attacked from the flanks, they wouldn't be able to take up their battle formation.
We benefited from our long years of service in the Roman army. We knew that in an ambush, Varus's legions would be completely lost. The Germans waited in the forest for the signal to attack. The trap was about to close.
The chronicler Cassius Dio wrote about the sequence of events.
Then suddenly the supposed subordinates appeared as enemies and caused a terrible calamity. At first, they threw spears. But then, when many Romans were already wounded, they changed to close combat. Nothing was more bloody than that catastrophe in the swamps and forests of Germania. None of the Romans could expect mercy. We were fighting for our freedom. But Arminius was in danger. As his friend and bodyguard, I protected his life.
Particulus wrote,
"Enclosed in forests and swamps, the Romans were slaughtered one by one by the same enemy whom they had always slaughtered like cattle."
Tacitus wrote,
"The forests of Germania were drenched in the blood of three legions."
Almost 20,000 Roman elite soldiers fell on the battlefield, disciplined and experienced men of the most powerful army of ancient times. The consequences for Rome were incalculable. They weren't just faced with the potential loss of the province of Germania. Gaul and Rome itself were also under threat, because after the destruction of the legions, there was nothing on the borders of the empire to hold the Germans back. In Rome, they said about the governor's death,
"He had more courage to die than to fight."
As governor and commander-in-chief, Varus held the sole responsibility for the ineradicable disgrace. For centuries, the search for the battlefield has occupied scholars, archaeologists, and local historians. They looked for signs of the battle in over 700 locations, which later became famous as the Battle of the Teutoburg Forest. But then, in 1987, in Kalkriese near Osnabrück, archaeologists found a battlefield. No others from the ancient world are known. It dates back to the time of Augustus. Is this the legendary site of Varus's last battle? Archaeologists have discovered almost 2,000 objects here, the legacy of an entire army. The discovered items were spread out over 10 kilometers, evidence that the army was attacked while moving. The most striking discovery, a Roman horseman's mask. Was that soldier fighting on the side of Rome, or was he one of the rebels? The only thing that is certain is that the mask was buried under a mound of earth. That's how it remained hidden from the Germans, who, after the battle, took everything of value with them. Metal was particularly desirable, armor and weapons. Valuables from the private property of the Romans also fell into their hands, like the legendary silver treasure of Hildesheim, a magnificent Roman dinner service from the time of Augustus. It probably belonged to one of the officers in the Varus legions and was taken as loot by a victorious German.
The battle was over, but the bloodshed wasn't. After years of oppression, exploitation, and humiliation, our hatred unloaded itself. Our priests sacrificed Roman captives to our gods. We celebrated Arminius, our commander. He now was undisputedly our leader. Never again, he announced, would a governor humiliate Germans like this. Never again would Rome rule over Germania. Finally, we were free. The Germanic tribes agreed. Arminius should lead them into the future.
A messenger from Germania finally arrived in Rome. A lot was at stake for Emperor Augustus. He had founded the empire and now had to legitimize his sole rule through successes. The emperor boasted of having expanded the empire to the Elbe and the seas of the north, but the message from Germania dashed his hopes. In anger and despair, he is said to have cried,
Quinctilius Varus, give me back my legions.
But not one of the Roman soldiers returned. All their families had left was a stone for an empty grave. Like the one for the Roman captain Caelius, he served in the 18th Legion and fell in Varus's war. For a long time, this gravestone was the only archaeological evidence of the Roman disaster.
Generally speaking, we can't call Varus incompetent. He was made the scapegoat, because a scapegoat was needed. There was no one else who could be made the scapegoat, except for someone who was dead.
After the disastrous defeat, Roman legions marched to Germania bent on revenge. 6 years after the Battle of the Teutoburg Forest, they discovered the battle's location. The skeletons of the dead were still hanging in the trees, ignoble for the sight and the memories, Tacitus said. The soldiers found altars on which Roman captives had been sacrificed. Tacitus also reported about bleached bones that were lying on the floor in heaps, or strewn out.
Nobody knew if he was burying his family members or strangers. They were all like friends and relatives.
Find after find tells the researchers more about the secret of Calpurnia. On the battlefield, they also came across pits with human bones. Are those the bones of the buried Romans that Tacitus wrote about? At the University of Göttingen, Birgit Großkopf is trying to find the answer to this question. The size and shape of the pelvis give information about the gender of the deceased. The result was clear. The bones in the pits were exclusively male. How old were the men when they died? Their teeth can help answer this question. The more worn they are, the older the person they belong to. The result here is quite clear too. All the men died between the ages of 20 and 40, the age of active legionaries. The analysis of the bones and teeth confirms the researcher's guess. The bones in Kalkriese belong to Roman legionaries. But were they the victims of a battle? Are there any further clues? There are also clear clues for fighting, an indication that a battle may have taken place. Here is an injury from a blow. He suffered a blow on the back of his head, which knocked out a large part of the cranium. The bones were found in a pit that was lined with limestone. The skulls and bones were carefully arranged in this mass grave. For the researchers, this is proof of a pious burial. Was it Romans who buried their fallen comrades in Kalkriese? 6 years after the battle, as we are told by Tacitus? If so, then the bones would give away if they had lain on the battlefield for quite some time before they were buried. This is another question Birgit Großkopf is investigating. Her results are once again unequivocal. Desiccation cracks and signs that the bones had been gnawed on by animals attest that the bones really did lie above the ground for several years. Is the search for the location of Varus's last battle finally over? All these insights can't be a coincidence, the researchers believe. They're convinced the battle really did take place in Kalkriese. After that fateful battle, the Romans withdrew all their legions from Germania. Tacitus recorded the emperor's instructions.
Now that Rome has had her revenge, the Cherusci and the other rebellious tribes can, as far as we are concerned, be left to their own internal disputes.
What happened to the Roman town near Waldgirmes, the flagship of civilization in the north? The excavation leader Armin Becker has been trying to find out when the town was abandoned. He's found a clearly darker layer in the ground sections. It is ash, a sign of destruction. That means the town must have been burned down. From a chain of clues, Armin Becker concludes that the Roman inhabitants left Waldgirmes after the Battle of the Teutoburg Forest in order to withdraw to the safety of the empire. They burned their own town to the ground. They didn't want anything to fall into the hands of the Germans.
If only Augustus had not been so intent on defeating Germania, it was lost with more disgrace than the glory it had been won with.
The lament of the Roman author Florus over the end of the dream of a Roman Germania. In the year 16 AD, Rome withdrew. Towns like Waldgirmes were burned down, along with military camps. A single battle had changed the course of history.
The entire region remained free from Roman rule. And so a Germanic constellation could arise that really did lead to a great advance of the Germans 300 years later. So what happened in the year 16 is something quite dramatic in Europe's history.
In the 19th century, Arminius was celebrated by nationally minded Germans with the erection of the pompous Hermann Memorial, Hermann being a Germanization of Arminius's name. It is historically undisputed that he permanently prevented the Romanization of the Germanic peoples. Tacitus wrote of him,
"There's no question he was the liberator of the Germanic peoples. He is still praised in songs by the barbaric tribes. After our victory over Rome, the old rivalries between the tribes broke out again. As the king of the Germans, Arminius wanted to increase his power and fame and unite the feuding tribes.
By making himself the sole ruler, Arminius broke with the old Germanic order. His ambitious will for power would bring him to his knees, as Tacitus explained.
Arminius, who wanted to rule as a king, had against him the sense of freedom of his fellow people. Some tribal leaders refused to subordinate themselves to Arminius's orders and referred to Germanic custom. But Arminius demanded unconditional obedience. He was killed by a blood relation. This time I wasn't able to protect the life of my friend.
Arminius died at the age of 37. Under his leadership, the Germans had won the decisive victory. They were to remain a constant threat to Rome.